All right, I'm sitting down with Mr. Munaring, and it's good to see you again, sir.
Yes.
Welcome back.
Thank you. Thank you for having me again, Mr. Shepherd. It's good to be back.
Yeah. Please introduce yourself and what you do.
Okay. Oh, my name is Malcolm, last name Munaring. From Mpumalanga, Bushbuckridge. I came to the Western Cape to pursue a career in medical laboratory science. So I studied a Bachelor of Health Science in medical laboratory science at Cape Peninsula University of Technology, 2011 years. That was my first year. So basically it's a profession which has multi-disciplines within it. It's a 4-year professional degree, whereby during your fourth year, it's like the research year or the honors year, and then specialization year, whereby you choose a discipline in which you want to pursue a career in. Like, for instance, I did there's a tri-discipline, whereby it has hematology, chemistry, as well as medical microbiology. And then there's other discipline called cytology, and other one histopathology, other one cytogenetics, and so forth and so forth. So the reason why I chose the tri one, which has three disciplines, is because there's better chances of, you know, of career development and job opportunities also, because it's three disciplines in one. So you can work in hematology, you can also work in chemistry, you can also work in medical microbiology lab, or maybe some labs, you know, actually they have like, you know, one small lab whereby they incorporate all the three. So you can be a suitable candidate
for that. For that,
yes.
So how long have you been doing it now?
Now it's 7 years.
Mm-hmm.
7 years now, yes.
Almost a decade.
Almost. That's almost count, I'm not sure, but yeah.
Yeah.
Let's just say it counts. But yeah, it's almost 10.
Mm.
Yeah.
In your experience, the 7 years that you have, what is it that you... Okay, I want to choose the question very carefully. Mm. What is it that you... What has been the most interesting thing about what you have been doing?
The most interesting thing? Okay, that's not so, you know, familiar question. I don't get it a lot. But yeah, interesting is that it's, the interesting part is that sometimes you, in that is a routine environment, right?
Mm.
And then when you get like something that is, or maybe the last time you saw that thing was, you know, second year, first year, when you were still
okay,
second,
sure.
You're like, oh yes, this is myelodysplastic syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
These features fit in perfectly with, you know, that's something that, you know, it revives
yeah,
you.
Yeah,
like,
you
oh, actually,
excited.
I am. Yeah, you get excited. Like, hey,
sure,
I remember
sure.
seeing this with Professor Davison back in second year.
Mm.
This is actually an acute, you know, leukemia, whatnot. So that's actually the interesting part when you see stuff that you know the theory of it, and then when you see it in practical, and then you get, you know,
sure.
that sense
yeah,
of,
revived, yeah.
Yes.
Mm. Yeah. Okay, and then do you work in both government, or you work in government, you move from government to private?
Yes, when I started, I was in government. I was in government. At,
and currently you're doing?
It's private now.
Okay.
Yeah.
Please just give us highlights, or like sort of explain how government does things, and what is the shift from government to private, and what can we learn from both?
Oh, okay. Yeah, number one, obviously, you know the economic status of the country, right?
Mm.
And the gap between the rich or poor. We can loosely, you know, put it like that. But obviously, it goes deep, like who is rich, who is poor.
Sure.
But we're just saying that the public side of the business, it's basically the major population. We caters for like 70 to 85% of the population. For instance, when a normal person goes to a clinic or hospital, that is a public facility, and then they draw samples, their blood, sputum, or urine, or whatever, it definitely goes to the public side of things, National Health Laboratory Service. That's the entity that caters for public health, you know, laboratory testing. And then when you go to private is like when you make an appointment with your doctor, your GP. And then when they take your samples, it goes to a private facility. Unless there's like a specialized test that is only done in that area, it's only done at the public facility, even though you're a private patient. And then there's that, you know, overlap. And then the what do you call this? When you call it a send away, you can send it away there to that facility for that test to be performed. But basically, private is like 20% of the population, whereby people can afford medical aid, you know, or they have cash. It's private clients, basically. Mm. So their testing is done in private companies.
Which one do you like the most between the two?
Which one do I like? Hey, that's very... I don't want to be a traitor. I don't want to be a traitor.
If you're not one of us, you're not one of us.
Wow. Okay. But I think each and every one has its own, you know, has its own, like, you know, preference. Downside. Yes, sure. Yes. Because in public, you've got better chance of getting, like, cases.
Mm.
That are
different
very,
cases,
yeah, different, yes. Type of cases, interesting cases, complicated cases,
sure.
Multidisciplinary cases, cases that needs like external, you know, consultations, because it's like, yeah, it's a lot. And then private also you do get, but because public, sometimes they do consult in private, so these two are interlinked. It's healthcare. I mean, primary healthcare, it can thingy. Either way, you can be a public client, but then if the public personnel or health professionals want to discuss or consult a complicated case, they do go to private consultants and consult.
Okay.
Say, hey, what's going on with this patient that, you know, presents with 1, 2, 3 symptoms?
Mm.
So what's your input on this? You see, that's all. But to choose. Obviously, I wouldn't, like, you know, readily choose and say, okay, this is what I would like.
Mm.
But I know in public, you get a lot of exposure, you get a lot of experience, you get a lot of knowledge, you know, how to solve a multidisciplinary, you know, case.
Mm.
Yeah.
So you're saying government?
It's good for knowledge.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
I'm gonna ask the same question. Like I asked before, but just in a different angle.
Oh.
So if you were to advise someone who's studying,
yes,
in their career,
yes,
what transition? Should they follow the transition that you did where you move from government to private, or you start from private to government? What advice can you give someone who's about to start their career?
Oh, okay. In that case, yes, definitely I would advise public facility for you to start your career, because obviously you are fresh, not so fresh, but then you just came from an institution of higher learning. You're looking to gather expertise. You're looking for experience, and then the government facility is the one that is definitely going to equip you, because you'll meet a lot of characters. You'll meet a lot of, you know, complicated cases. You know, that fits to a textbook, you know, sort of definition or structure. So it's best to start at public, because when you go to private now, it's like more, it's business. It's business, it's competitive, it's numbers. Obviously still healthcare, they have to, it's quality control, it's, you know, it's off standard. But I mean, like, at the end of the day, it's business. It's a group of people that came together and say, hey, let's do this. So the dynamics might be a little bit different in terms of knowledge, research, and development. So I would definitely advise private to start there. And then when you feel like you're ready now to conquer the world, then you can go wherever.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Then, where is this question now?
Exactly. Where is the question?
The question is going with the echo.
Okay. Okay. It's him telling me he's got an echo and it's fine.
No, I'm not trying to do anything. Okay, let me put it this way.
Yes.
So now you've worked for the past 7 years, right?
Yes.
How do you improve your skills? Mm-hmm. You did mention that it's repetition work, mm-hmm. but how do you improve your skills to become better and more sharper?
And more sharp. Okay, definitely there is what we call like within, I think each and every company is, because I've been both private and public, they do have like courses to enhance you or to check if your competence is still on par, you're still in line with the guidelines like the Health Profession Council of South Africa. Mm-hmm. So there's talks by experts in the field whereby you're supposed to attend and engage and then do like assessments and to see that, okay, you are still compliant. And then other than that, there's also like training. Each and every company has like a training, you know, policy whereby they outsource like training academies and stuff for their staff to go there. Like for instance, if you wanna branch into marketing, there is a marketing course. If you wanna branch to marketing within the medical field. If you wanna branch to project management, if you wanna branch to epidemiology, or research and development, yeah. So there is like help.
So sort of from growth looks like pivoting. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
To change streams completely.
Yes, yes. You can.
No, I mean, like, is that what growth means for you guys, or do you sort of have to still stick towards the same thing, but just add, like you said, pathology.
Listen to it. Yeah, but I think it depends with you. I think it's open. Mm-mm-mm. It depends to you if you want to grow within the same. You want to be a marketer within the same industry. Mm-mm. You want to be a project manager within the industry.
Sure.
Or if you want to do something else.
Sure.
And then there is help, then obviously they can send you. But I'm not sure of how private works in terms of branching out. Because remember, it's a company also. Mm-mm. They need to equip their employees.
Sure.
Somewhat benefit to the company. So they won't like fully or exclusively, you know, equip you with something that will propel
make
you to leave. If they wanna, you know, equip you with skills and stuff, it's something that somehow will benefit the company. So, but it's up to you how you're gonna use it. Because obviously after being equipped with a certain skill, and then you can decide to serve certain years within the company. As per contract that, okay, you gave me an education of, you know, project management. And then as per contract, I'm willing to serve the 4 years. And then after that, I'll decide what I'll do with myself. And then I can completely branch out, you know, project management. I can go to business. I can go to, you know, so forth and so forth.
Okay. Yeah. The reason why we're having this conversation is because we have had a conversation before,
yes.
And I like the way that our conversation is flowing.
Yeah.
Because it's just a continuation of the information that you shared,
yes,
earlier on. And I'm saying this because someone might just say that these guys are sounding so relaxed and enjoying themselves. But I would implore you, please go look at the old conversation that we had with Mr. Mnareng. He goes into detail what we talked about, what is medical bioscience,
medical laboratory sciences. Yes,
and then there's we went into depth on that, right?
Yeah, we did.
So I'm gonna ask this last two questions, right?
Yes.
What is the future looking like for you in terms of growth, and also maybe advise a student who's studying MLS. Mm-hmm. That's what you called it last time.
Yes.
MLS now. So who's studying it now? And I will ask the last question just after you answer this.
Okay. Well, obviously, they need to make an informed decisions. Mm. They need to get what we refer to as a career counseling, talk to someone, or listen to the podcast, yes. Mm. And make sure or be sure of what they're really getting themselves into. Like, obviously, you can be interested of something you see walk on the street, but do you really want it? It's up to you to make the research, and then when you find like proper, you know, advice into it and knowledge into it, and then definitely go for it. I would suggest that obviously you go for it and then make the use of it, and then you'll never get stuck. There's always help. There's like consultants, there's like experts, there's like, you know, people that have been there before, so they can give you knowledge about the course. Yes.
Awesome. What's the next step for you?
Next step for me, I have to, you know, I am looking into postgraduate, right?
Mm-hmm.
I was, I did a application with the University of Stellenbosch for Masters of Science in Epidemiology.
Mm.
Yeah. So that is what we're looking into. That's the direction that
we
want to head to. Oh, listen to you. Well, sure. That's the whole plan. That's the whole plan. I don't want to go home. So sure. Like, well, I go big, right?
Sure. Go big or go home.
Yes, exactly. So that's where we're looking to branch into.
Sure.
It's still within the health sector. It's still within, you know, discussing like, you know, pathogens and study of its prevalence and stuff. So that's the direction that we want to take.
Well, on that, Stege Podcast is rooting for you. And we can't wait for you to be called Dr. Malcolm.
Right.
And I hope you give us your first interview. Mm-hmm. And that's sort of the culture that we're trying to create.
Yeah.
And talking about culture, we have a name for the listeners now. We call them the workforce.
The workforce.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Because they are working to enhance our economy.
Yes.
And we are the workforce of the economy.
Oh.
So for everyone who's listening out there, you guys are the workforce.
Uh-huh.
Not chillers.
Listen to you.
You are the workforce. So thank you so much for sharing your journey, and we really appreciate you coming through, and we value you, and thank you so much for coming through.
Yes.
And in closing, what has been the recurring theme in your career, and how has it helped you?
A recurring theme. Should I say drive, passion, constantly seeking, you know, to equip myself with the skills and the knowledge. As I go, you know, sometimes we get a degree, we go to work, and then we just sit down.
Mm.
Not sit down, but I mean, like, we just relaxed, and like, we think we're cruising nicely, but we're like innate or dormant. So it's the drive, it's the constant drive.
Sure.
And the need and the hunger to constantly, you know, do more and constantly look for more and constantly like search for new interesting things to make the career, you know, worthwhile and interesting.
Sure.
So that for me, I think it's been the driving force.
Yeah.
Yes.
Exciting stuff. With us, and thank you so much, sir, for coming through.
Mm-hmm.
We definitely see the drive.
Yes.
And let's go for that master's. Let's go for that doctorate.
Yes.
And we're rooting for you. And the workforce is rooting for you as well.
All right.
Have a wonderful day, sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. It's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you for having me. I'm glad I could share, you know, a bit of a story with the workforce. Yes, with the workforce. So yeah, thanks for having me.
Sure. Thanks. Thank you so much for listening to this episode. I appreciate you taking time and tuning in and be part of our community. We get to share ideas, stories, and perspectives through this podcast. I hope you enjoyed it and found something valuable in it. Don't forget to subscribe and share with your family and friends. I look forward to connecting with you in the next episode. Until then, take care. This is Stega Podcast signing out. See you next time.